Hello, my name is Peggy Beecham. It's my pleasure and a distinct honor to introduce to you Montco Bible Fellowship's members of the class of 2020. This year, Montco has been blessed with four new graduates from high school, one graduate from college, and one recipient of a degree at the graduate level. For all of us, and particularly for these grads, 2020 will forever be remembered as a year of unprecedented challenges, a pandemic with previously unknown health issues, and an overwhelming loss of life. Ongoing racial injustice that ignited protests over systemic racism inherent in this country's history for more than 400 years. This year has necessitated fundamental changes in the way we live, the way we teach and learn, the way we socialize, and where we worship. Some members of the class of 2020 were born near the end of the 20th century, and others during the beginning of the 21st century. Many of us wondered about what changes we would face as the calendar transitioned from the 1990s to the 2000s. These 2020 graduates were too young to realize it at the time, but sadly, everything changed on 9/11/2001, when the single deadliest terrorist attack in history was carried out against the U.S. When these graduates were a little older, they may not have understood the significance, but they came to know their first president, when President Barack Obama was elected for the first of his two terms in 2008. That same year, their families had to manage the difficulties associated with the recession of 2008. As they completed elementary school, middle school, high school, or college, new topics were added to their classroom discussions, such as the evidence of or denial of, and urgently needed solutions to, climate change. Then, even as some parents thought they were still too young to understand, they became aware of the growing interest and the changes, first in state laws, and then in 2015, rulings by the Supreme Court that redefined marriage as we always had known it, according to the Bible. Fast forward to the beginning of 2020, the long-awaited graduation year for our honorees. But then January ended with a tragic helicopter crash that took the lives of Lakers basketball star Kobe Bryant, his 13-year-old daughter, and seven other passengers. At that time, we still had no idea about the coming pandemic and its global impact, the likes of which had not been seen in over 100 years. So here we are, 3.5 months in, still coping, still praying without ceasing, still adjusting to what is considered the new normal. For the class of 2020, the new normal meant transforming the traditional special events that mark the completion of high school, such as senior trips, senior proms, class awards nights, graduation, and graduation parties. Instead of going to a prom, students posed for photo shoots wearing that one-of-a-kind perfect gown or GQ quality tuxedo. Some high schools held virtual award ceremonies. Many delivered special boxes containing personalized yard signs for each grad, along with their cap and gown and other graduation gifts from the school. In place of a graduation ceremony, schools organized socially distanced programs in which grads in caps and gowns, some wearing masks, walked onto the stage of an empty auditorium or across a platform constructed on the school track. There they received individual recognition as each name was called. Then they collected their diploma from a stack on a table, and finally they posed, remembering to smile as a photographer captured this once-in-a-lifetime moment. Many colleges and universities opted for virtual commencements, streamed online for grads and their families, and accessible by the public. These ceremonies included deans of schools from various disciplines wearing their traditional robes and hoods as they verbally conferred degrees on the graduates from their school of study. The graduates were watching from home. No matter how the members of the class of 2020 were honored, virtually or otherwise, we celebrate all of their academic achievements so far, and we applaud their perseverance and their faithfulness through extraordinary circumstances. We pray that God will continue to bless and keep them throughout all their future endeavors. And a word of scripture for encouragement. Isaiah 30, 18 to 26. God will be gracious. Therefore, the Lord will wait that he may be gracious to you. And therefore, he will be exalted that he may have mercy on you. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all those who wait for him. For the people shall dwell in Zion at Jerusalem. You shall weep no more. He will be very gracious to you at the sound of your cry. When he hears it, he will answer you. And though the Lord gives you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, yet your teachers will not be moved into a corner anymore. But your eyes shall see your teachers. Your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, "This is the way, walk in it." Whenever you turn to the right hand, or whenever you turn to the left. And now for our graduates. Foster. Charity was born on November 19, 2001 in Abington, Pennsylvania. She has received her high school diploma as a member of the class of 2020.
I received my high school diploma from Upper Dublin High School, and in high school I was very, very involved. I served as a member of the student government, as a member of the National Honor Society, and as the communications leader of the Black Student Union. I ran track and cross country as a freshman and a sophomore, and I also served as co-president of our Agape Christian Fellowship this year. This year, I also served as a yearbook editor, which I really enjoyed. I was also very active in a lot of youth ministries, and one of my proudest high school accomplishments was receiving the Photography Award, which is awarded to one senior who has demonstrated artistic expertise and talent in the field of photography. and I intend to use these skills like photography as I go on to study visual communications, and as well in my travels abroad later this year. I hope to become a creative director in the future, and I hope to use the creative gifts that God has given me to help the world. I want to thank my parents, Chelsea and Charles Foster, my family, my teachers, and my Montco family for their unwavering support. I've attended Montco since I was 6 years old, and I'm excited to grow in my faith in my next endeavors.
Ariana Chantal Henderson. Ariana was born on January 11, 2002 in Lansdale, Pennsylvania. She has received her high school diploma as a member of the class of 2020.
I graduated this year from North Penn High School. Some of my favorite memories include going to school events and playing on my school's tennis team. I enjoy watching movies, baking, getting food with my friends, and shopping. I was awarded the AAUW, which stands for American Association of University Women Excellence in Writing Award. I was a member of National Honor Society, and I was recognized as most congenial on my tennis team. I won a partial scholarship to the University of Pittsburgh, a Pendale Alumni Scholarship, which is where I attended middle school, and also the North Penn High School Guidance Department Award, and also the Class of 2012 Senior Award, which I got for being very involved in my school. I was a member of Link Crew, which is basically the upperclassmen that help the sophomores get acclimated to life at the high school, because my high school starts sophomore year instead of freshman year. I was also a member of Class Cabinet, which helps organize events for our grade. I was a vice president of People vs. Poverty Club, as well as a tutor in Study Buddies, which tutors fifth graders in math. And I was on the tennis team for 3 years. I was also the boys' tennis manager this year. I plan on enrolling at the University of Pittsburgh in the fall. My major is undecided. And I would like to give a shout out to my parents, Anthony and Bethany Henderson, as well as my sister, Alexis Henderson, and my friends and mentors at Montco who have poured into my life, supported me, and helped me get to where I am today. I would like to continue developing a relationship with God in college and the rest of my life.
Grace Miriam Holt. Grace was born on July 5th, 1988 in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. She has received a second master's degree and is a member of the class of 2020.
Hello. It's so nice to be with everybody and talk about this graduation educational accomplishment of getting my second master's degree from Lincoln University of Pennsylvania. This master's degree is in early childhood education, which is in kindergarten all the way up to fourth grade elementary education certification. I have a bachelor's degree in psychology from Norfolk State University. And I have a master's degree that I got in 2017 from California University of Pennsylvania. And the master's degree is in conflict resolution. While I was taking my first master's degree classes, I took some educational courses and I was like really intrigued and really interested in. I decided to be a substitute teacher once I graduated with that degree. When I was in the classroom, it was like magic from day one. And I said, well, this is it. This is my calling. Like, I've been to be a teacher. I want to educate young minds. So I started my second master's degree at Lincoln University, and here I am now. And Lincoln University is in Philadelphia, the campus that I went to, which is on 30th Market Street. And I'm so happy because the Lord has definitely blessed me through this educational endeavor. And he gave me perseverance, he gave me tenacity, and most of all, he gave me favor. My spiritual mother and father are my aunt and my uncle. And my aunt's name is Antoinette Collier, and my uncle's name is Liddell Collier. And they're my biggest advocates. They push me, they motivate me. Whenever I feel like giving up or throwing in the towel, they say, no, you have to keep on going. They give me a right amount of tough love, a right amount of comfort, and a right amount of just that push that I need, that everybody needs when sometimes, you know, the going gets tough. And I can honestly say that I could not have accomplished what I accomplished without my Montco Bible Fellowship family. And I've been a member at this beautiful fellowship church ever since, I want to say 2018, and I was baptized last year. Some spiritual goals are, I would like to write books about conflict resolution, where I want to give scenarios about different conflicts and the sound resolutions to use to solve those conflicts, coming from a theoretical perspective and also a Christian perspective. I want to add some humor into the book because I think that humor, like, is good for the soul, and it brings everyone together, and it makes everybody, like, just people feel like feelings of comfort and feelings of just happiness that, you know, life sometimes can be tough, but it's also a good way, you know, a good thing to do sometimes, just laugh and just have a good time, but also be led by God's teaching. I knew that the Lord had a special anointing on my life because at the tender age of 4, on Christmas night, I taught my own self how to read. I prayed after getting a book called the Read It Yourself Storybook, which was written by Princeton educators. And I said, Jesus, can you please teach me how to read? I want to do this so badly. And then I prayed, and next thing you know, I was like literally reading. And my aunt said, no way, Grace, you didn't read that book again. So then I read the book to her. She said, oh my goodness, you taught yourself how to read. And it was just amazing. She called all my family and put them on speaker, and I read them passages out of the book on Christmas night. So that's a little snippet of how the Lord already had a calling on my life to teach and to lead the way and, you know, just teach the minds of the youth. And I think that God is definitely a big motivating factor in my educational life. And one of my favorite memories of getting this master's degree is that whenever I would have like a moment where I would feel like stressed or like a little bit like, what's the word I'm looking for? Just like needed that push. Dr. Leah will always say to me, Grace, why are you worried? You're the most conscientious student at Lincoln, if not one of the best students. Stop worrying, you're a superstar. You have nothing to worry about. You're fine, Grace. So just hearing those words will always give me that extra jump that I need to keep on pushing and keep on going. And here I am now, graduating from Lincoln. And my career goals, I was just recently hired at Global Leadership Academy to teach first grade. It was a really strenuous and tough process. Going through the interviews, because I had like about 5 interviews in a short period of time, and they were really tough. And I kept saying, well, do they want me? Like, am I gonna, because they were just really, they use a fine tooth comb when choosing their teachers, they're really selective. And when they chose me, I'm like, wow, this is amazing. This is definitely a blessing from God to be able to teach at a school that is so well respected and that takes their teachers seriously, who actually care about the students. And Global Leadership Academy is located in West Philly, and I just think that it feels good to give back to a school system where I came from, which is a Philadelphia school system, and at a charter school at Global Leadership, you know, it's just a blessing from God, and I'm definitely counting every single blessing, because God is good and He is faithful. And my motivation and what gives me my drive, what gives me my perseverance, what gives me my tenacity is Jesus Christ, you know. And I believe that this is not the end of the road here, that I'm going to keep on going, I'm going to keep on pushing, and maybe one day even get a PhD. So I'm really thankful for this moment of being with the class of 2020, coming from Lincoln University.
Alexis Danae Grady. Alexis is a fellow Bison and proud member of the Howard University graduating class of 2020.
I have earned my Bachelor of Arts in Political Science with a minor in Economics and a pre-law concentration. Previously, I graduated from Cheltenham High School, which is located in Wincote, Pennsylvania. During the past 4 years, I have been involved in several extracurricular activities. I served as the chair of the Howard University Student Association Senate, and before that, as the director of student advocacy for the College of Arts and Sciences. I was also a member of the WIPNEV Revolt, which is a community service organization on campus. I made the dean's list for each of my last 4 semesters at Howard and completed 7 internships in the field of public policy. Most recently, I interned for Congresswoman Rashida Tlaib in her DC office. My favorite memory of Howard is springtime on the yard, where you can find Black people of all walks of life in community with one another. Howard taught me that there is no one way to be Black, but to take pride in the legacy of our race. While at Howard, my hobbies included working with local shelters for homeless youth and running on the National Mall. As far as postgrad plans, this fall, I will be starting at Georgetown Law in pursuit of my JD. I hope to become a public interest lawyer to serve underrepresented communities. I could not have gotten into law school or finished undergrad without the support of my parents, Rochelle and Cleveland Grady, my brothers, and my friends at Howard. I am most grateful that the Lord heard my prayers through the LSAT and the application process. It is especially nice to share this moment with Montco, as I have attended Montco since I was born, for 22 years. My spiritual goals include completing the new members class at my new church home in Washington, D.C., becoming closer to the Lord through prayer, and finding new ways to use my spiritual gifts to serve people in my community during these unprecedented times. I hope the Lord will continue to guide my path and use me as He sees fit. Thank you for your time and this opportunity.
Kimberly Elise West. Kimberly was born on January 7th, 2003 in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. She has received her high school diploma as a member of the class of 2020.
I graduated from Springfield Township High School. My favorite memory was participating and watching sports games. Other activities I participated in were outdoor track for 3 years, indoor track for 2 years, and I also participated in the pen relays for 10th and 11th grade. My favorite race was the 4x1 relay. Although I will not be continuing my track career, it taught me a lot of discipline. Another activity I enjoyed while in high school was art. I took a variety of different art classes throughout all 4 years, my favorite being sculpture. I even got the opportunity to have some of my art displayed in some of the school's art shows. I received an award for math in 11th grade, specifically algebra, for outstanding student. And math also happened to be my favorite subject. I will be attending Westchester University in the fall as a pre-business marketing major. I'm not 100% sure on my plans for the future, but I'm using business as a starting place as I'm interested in entrepreneurship. I would also like to join clubs while I'm there and get involved in the school. I would like to thank my dad, Edward West, my brother, Brandon West, my aunt, Patricia Russell, and my uncle, Courtney Russell, as well as my extended family for pushing me to my full potential. A personal accomplishment of mine was being the youngest in my class. I was moved up early to first grade, and from then on, I've been able to keep up within my grade level. I'm excited to accomplish things and go outside of my comfort zone. I have attended Montco since I was very young, and my spiritual goals include continuing to strengthen my relationship with God.
Alani Grace Leon. Alani was born on August 19, 2002 in Abington, Pennsylvania. She has received her high school diploma and is a member of the class of 2020.
I graduated from Abington Senior High School. I've been attending Montco Bible Fellowship my whole life. My favorite memories from high school were meeting my best friends. My favorite teacher from high school was my chemistry teacher, Mr. Viscarello. Some of my hobbies include drawing and dancing. My plans for the future are to attend Temple University and receive my bachelor's degree in graphic design. And with that degree, I plan to use it to get a job with a New York magazine. My mom, Tammy, and my dad, Ricky, really helped me with my high school journey. They helped me to keep track. They helped to keep me motivated and to stay on track when I've had papers and projects to do. I would really like to thank them for that. My spiritual goal is to keep my relationship with God as a top priority.
Good morning, Montco, and welcome back to our Adult Sunday School Online. If you happen to be watching this video separate from the normal Sunday morning stream of the Montco Bible Fellowship, my name is Charles Foster, and I am the teacher for the Adult Sunday School, and we have been doing this Sunday School version online since the time of quarantine. And even though Montco Bible Fellowship is again meeting live, we are still doing Sunday School online for those who are home and for those who want to enjoy it later. So, as we continue on July the 5th, that's right, we're in the month of July. Who would have thought, right? We are continuing with our Bible survey, looking at the big picture of the various books of the Bible. We've gone through an overview portion of the books of the Pentateuch. We've gone through those 12 historical books. We've gotten through those books of wisdom and poetry where we started online. And now we are in the major prophets, and we are finishing up with Daniel part 2 today, which means we are finishing that section of the major prophets today. As we continue, we look at this outline here. Last week, we did the biographical section. That's the portion 1 through 6. Those chapters are more familiar to most people because it's those stories that we heard about, even if we haven't read them. And then today, we're going to do that prophetic section, which is not as familiar and sometimes confusing to those who try to read it. So as we get into that, first thing we got to do is establish the fact, and we talked about it last week, the book of Daniel is in the category of writings in scripture that is apocalyptic. Apocalyptic means something that was previously hidden that's now uncovered, now revealed, now unveiled. So when you're looking at books like this, books like the book of Revelation, books like what we talked about in Ezekiel last week, certain portions of that, Joel, Habakkuk, you're talking about something that God is revealing to us, usually related to end times. And you know, we have a tendency to think of when we think about things with end times, usually somebody doing something kind of crazy, right? And the world can do that especially. Or even if it happens in real life and it's not a cartoon, it's usually something that's way off. But here's the thing about apocalyptic readings. A lot of us try to read it and we get very confused. So we're going to see, especially with the book of Revelation, if you don't know the book of Daniel, then you're not going to really understand the book of Revelation. As a matter of fact, the book of Revelation assumes that you have a working knowledge of the Old Testament so you can figure out and understand what a lot of those symbols mean. Because when a lot of these books were written, a lot of times they're written, number one, they're writing it to people who they know would have an understanding of it. But also, some of it is written in a way to hide it from others and only believers would know. Hidden because, remember, a lot of that church, as we're talking about with the book of Revelation in particular, were being persecuted at the time. So there are some things we got to understand about Daniel today if you're going to go on and read the book of Revelation when we eventually get to that. Now, of course, Hollywood has its own interpretation of apocalyptic scriptures too, and is usually something like this.
And I will strike down upon thee with great vengeance and furious anger those who attempt to poison and destroy my brothers. And you will know my name is the Lord.
Some of you might be familiar with that clip. And what the reason I showed is because Hollywood is not going to be just quoting scripture for the most part, right? But usually when it comes to this type of scripture, it's usually some killer, some psychopath, somebody who's going to unleash their wrath on some unsuspecting victim. And it's been perverted in that way. So let's move on to someone who can present it in a much more positive way, Pastor Landon, as he gives us an overview of the next two chapters we're going to be getting into. Now, we did 1-6 last week, that sense of refusal by the Hebrew boys and Daniel, of course. And now, as we get into something very significant from chapter 7, especially in 8, let's take a listen to Pastor Landon.
Okay, how about some ones you don't know? That's the refusal part, chapters 1-6. Now the revelation part, chapters 7-12. And the book changes here from being written in the third person to being written in the first person, moving from historical and biographical to personal. The visions in these chapters happen during the reigns of Darius, Belshazzar, and Cyrus, and they're arranged non-chronologically. Daniel sees four main visions. He sees a vision of four beasts, a ram and a goat, 70 weeks, and the last days. First, Daniel sees four terrifying beasts. There's a lion with eagle's wings that turn into a man, a symbol for Babylon, a bear that's bigger on one side of his body with three ribs in his mouth, that's the Medo-Persian Empire, a leopard with four wings, that's the Greek Empire, and a horrifying, dreadful beast with iron teeth and 10 horns. That's the Roman Empire, and then the future form of the Roman Empire. The smallest horn had eyes and a mouth, but the Ancient of Days came and sat on his throne and destroyed the horn. It's crazy stuff. Right after this vision is a massive Jesus moment in the Old Testament. Daniel prophesies in the middle of the night, coming with the clouds of heaven, one like a son of man. To him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people should serve him. Daniel says, his dominion is an everlasting dominion which won't pass away. The one we've been waiting for, the one the people in exile longed for, the son of man, Jesus Christ, the Messiah. Jesus himself references these prophecies of Daniel in Matthew chapter 24, which is one of the main sections of prophecy in the New Testament, and it's kind of like Jesus' own miniature prophetic book.
All right, excellent as usual, and we're now in this revelation portion, right, 7-12, and the reason the focus is so much on 7 is because if you look at the first scripture in chapter 7, it says that in the first year of Belshazzar, right, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream. So now Daniel's having the dream. Remember, previously, Nebuchadnezzar had the dream and Daniel interpreted it. Now the dream is given directly to him. And the vision passed through his mind as he was laying on his bed and he wrote down the substance of his dream. So let's see what he wrote down. Just as we go through chapter 7 here, we're going to focus on these four beasts and these four beasts line up exactly with Nebuchadnezzar's dream. Remember, he talked about the, Daniel interpreted this from Daniel chapter 2, the iron, oh, I shouldn't say iron, sorry about that, the gold head that represented the Babylonian culture, the silver chest, breastplate, torso represented the Medo-Persian culture, the bronze portion of the torso, that lower portion, represented the Greek dynasty, Alexander the Great, and the last part, which was a mixture in that sense of clay, and a particular feet of clay, was which we got that expression from, represented the Roman culture. As we continue in this and look at chapter 8, chapter 8 kind of talks about this ram and this goat. And what's so interesting about that is that he's making reference with the ram to the part of that map that you see down there in the south, the kind of purple, whatever color that is, and where it encompasses Egypt and some of the regions down there. And then the goat is a reference to the Greek Empire that has now taken over the Persian Empire, and in particular with Alexander the Great, because he definitely is in a lot of this. And here's the amazing thing. He wrote this, I'm talking about Daniel now, wrote this some 300 years before Alexander even shows up on the scene. 200 or 300. Let me think about my, I'll add it up in my head in a second. You know what? Even if it was 100, it's amazing. But so the fact that he's saying this is once again why people question this. And when you're thinking about Alexander, what's interesting is he's the one that's the GOAT. I don't mean greatest of all time GOAT, but I mean, although I'm sure some historians might say that. But here's the interesting thing. If you look at these two coins, you notice how around his ear, it looks like a horn there on the left. And then it's clearly on top of his head, some horns there in the gold one on the right, because the gold, as you see there in the yellow print from Daniel 8:5, it speaks of him. Remember, a couple hundred years before he shows up, he's being referred to as this goat. And people actually refer to him as not only Alexander the Great, but also Alexander the Goat, without even knowing about this prophecy. God was just cooking. Like we said this last week, God was clearly hooking up Daniel with what was going on in the future in history. Take a look at chapter 9 right here. This is so significant. As we just kind of brush through this a little bit, but it's so significant as it relates to the Jewish people and as it relates to us also. So we're going to let Pastor Landon give us an overview of 9, especially, but 9 through 12. So let's take one more listen.
After 9 years later, he prays this huge prayer of repentance for his people in exile. Gabriel, the angel, comes and shares a vision of 70 futuristic weeks. There's a lot of interpretations of this chapter. If you view the Bible in a dispensational or a covenantal way, I'd like to do a whole video series on these chapters, but needless to say, you should read and study these chapters and pray for God to illuminate them for you. But just about everybody agrees on this thing, that the first 69 weeks are about the rebuilding of Jerusalem and Israel after the exile, the death of the Messiah, and the last week, the 7 years that lead up to the return of the Messiah, Jesus, that one happens in the future. In chapter 10, Daniel sees the same terrifying messenger from God that Ezekiel saw. It's got arms and legs of bronze, eyes of fire, a body like a green gemstone, and a golden belt. Daniel's greeted by the messenger with love. He says, "O Daniel, greatly loved." And he introduces the prophecies of chapter 11, in which Daniel foretells in impossible detail things that would happen centuries into the future. If anything shakes your confidence in the Bible being God's word, read this chapter and look up what happened in history. It's all the exact same, and Daniel foretold it through the power of God years in advance. Chapter 12 ends the book with comfort and clarity. Daniel says, "Those who are wise, they'll shine like the brightness of the sky above, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever."
Okay, back from Pastor Landon, an excellent overview of, in particular, the way he did chapter 9, because a lot of churches, a lot of believers disagree on that, and he covered it in a nice general way, as we are too. That little picture we showed you right before he came on with the, I guess that's the sick emoji. That's a reference to chapter 8, where Daniel is just overwhelmed after he receives this prophecy of the ram and the goat, and he has to just rest and sleep for a while because he's just worn out from the spiritual understanding and the vision that he is now getting. Prophecy of Daniel. Now, you saw this in chapter 2 with the gold and the silver and the bronze and the clay here, right? But if you look up what lines up with it, all right, so you got this sense of 70 weeks. And when we're talking about 70 weeks, now this is when Israel is still back in their land, right? So you got them sinning, but also part of their sin is the way they treated the land. Because what essentially is happening here for a period of 490 years, right? And that should sound familiar, because remember Ezekiel had to lay down for a certain number directly related to that, right? God is hooking all this up now. For a period of 490 years, they were supposed to be letting the land rest when they're planting their crops and everything back when they were in Israel. They were supposed to be letting the land rest every 7 years. But they didn't for that time period, right? And that was told to them in the book of Leviticus. And because you know what happened. First of all, God said, "You let it rest and I'm going to take care of you. You'll probably have an overabundance." But they didn't. They got greedy. They tried to make land. They were disobedient. And God is saying, "You know what? You don't want to listen? The land will get its rest." So let's see. 470 years. Every 7 years, I do some little division there. That comes out to 70. So for 70 years, this land going to rest now because you're getting taken out of here. So that's a big part of why they're in captivity. And of course, obviously, we know all the other stuff with the idolatry and immorality and the ungratefulness and all that. But they're in captivity for this time period of 70 years, right? And we know about the temple being destroyed and everything. But here's what's interesting. Another time period starts of 70 weeks, right? And when we say 70 weeks, we're talking about not a week of days, but a week of years. So we're talking about a large time period also. But look what happens during part of this time. Now, what's referred to as the time of the Gentiles, because you see what's going on up here. What happens here? You know, all Gentile culture is just exploding at this point, right? And our Messiah is rejected here, right? So let's show you kind of a little bit more what we're talking about. Here we go. The 70th week of this, right? So this is about the Messiah. So we get to this 70th week. Remember the 70 weeks, right? Look what's going to happen here. And this is from Daniel saying this hundreds of years, 400 years basically, before the Messiah shows up. And it says, know therefore and understand that from the going forth from the commandment to restore and build Jerusalem. Remember, he was going to decree that, right? Jerusalem is going to be rebuilt. I'm letting them out of here. And they're going to leave. Unto the Messiah Prince, that time period shall be 7 weeks. We're talking about years now, right? And 2 weeks. So here's the thing. When it says that Messiah, that's Mashiach Nagid in Hebrew, right? The Messiah Prince. Remember we told you before that the book of Daniel is the first Old Testament book to use that term Messiah, Mashiach. But look what happens here. It says in the very next verse that this Messiah shall be cut off, karat. So think about it. He's showing up and then he's cut off. And that word, karat right there, actually means to cut down, to cut short, to essentially wipe out. You see what that's pointing to? It's pointing to our Messiah who came in, who was welcomed in to the very day when people looked at this and figured out all these days and everything, to the very day what they figured out what these right here mean. That means that when he comes riding in on Palm Sunday, and then he's going to be cut off shortly after that. Now, you know, somebody who's a higher critic is not going to believe that, right? There's no way somebody can predict all this accurately to the day. That's why the book of Daniel is so amazing, because a God that's outside of space, outside of time, revealed all this to him. We stopped there for a reason, because this prophecy does go beyond what happens when after the Messiah is rejected and everything. But the reason we stopped there is because it would take us to all kinds of paths, meaning eschatology, end times, right? If you go into end times, what the book of Daniel does, what the book of Ezekiel does, and I touched on a little bit also, you got two views here. You got three views here, and you got another two here. So if we tried to cover all these, and they're very fascinating, and then you could make a decision as to which one you believe, meaning this, all of these are held by believers. I'm not saying that some of these people are unsaved and everything. A lot of them are believers, love the Lord. They just believe different things about what's going to happen in the end. And a lot of it is from the misinterpretation of the book of Revelation, but also you don't understand what the book of Daniel and how it's related to the book of Revelation too. So it's a lot there, as I said. Churches have minor squabbles over this, but there's just another last thing we have to get to, and that's related to something that's kind of controversial. And you know what that is? This whole thing of the Antichrist. Because he's mentioned in Daniel here, and he's certainly mentioned in the book of Revelation. The Antichrist is interesting because look at all the people who have been accused of being the Antichrist in the past. John F. Kennedy, Ronald Reagan, Sun Myung Moon, Bill Clinton, Bill Gates, Oh, that's not just a pass, right? Prince Charles and Barack Obama. By the way, most presidents at some time or another have been on that list, especially if they're charismatic. You look who's on that list there, right? Because nobody's going to accuse Herbert Hoover of being the Antichrist. But you talk about Nero. People thought he was the Antichrist at that time because of some of the things he was doing that are directly related to things that are listed in the book of Daniel. A current president. Stars, you know, celebrities. Historically, you got popes. There's a lot of popes. I think that's the first pope there, but a lot of popes. Obviously, you can see how people thought it was Hitler and Napoleon. By the way, they're all wrong, obviously. Every person listed there is not the Antichrist. First of all, some of the people that we see as being so evil, the Antichrist is not going to come across that way. He's going to be beloved. And of course, Hollywood, just like we talked about with the apocalyptic scripture, has a tendency to have their own take, television, movies, on the Antichrist also. So let's take a brief look at that.
Definitely not.
Mr. Setz, did you kill Buckley?
Sure. You realize you killed his death? I didn't care, sir.
Why'd you kill him, Mr. Setz?
Well, I had to kill him. My dog told me it was the Antichrist.
What's his name, Mr. Setz?
His name is Petey. He's a Dalmatian.
I just showed that because if you're wondering about the Antichrist, and the better question is, who is the Antichrist as opposed to is the Antichrist real? Because based on scripture, the Antichrist is or will be a real live person. But I would say this, I wouldn't rack my brain over it because the reality is that if you're in Christ and you know who you belong to and you are, put it this way, if you're a modern day representation of what Daniel, of what those Hebrew boys were, you don't have anything to worry about. And I'm not saying you got to be perfect. What I'm saying is this. It's about your father being stronger. Essentially, your dad can beat up his dad. And you know who I'm talking about. Also, depending on what theory of eschatology you believe, you probably ain't going to be here to see them if you believe certain things, all right? So don't rack your brain over it. But here's what we got to think about. He's mentioned in the book of Revelation. He's certainly mentioned in the book of Daniel. And when he's mentioned here, it gives a pretty good description so that those who are remaining, those who see the Antichrist, all right, we'll say it that way. Because I'm probably giving away certain things to those who are more abreast in eschatology. It's not going to be difficult to figure out if you know your word who that Antichrist is. And all those people I showed before do not fit the bill. Let's just continue. Here we go. That covered chapter 11 right there from Daniel related to the Antichrist. Now, as we go into chapter 12, what's so good about it is that Daniel kind of wraps all this up and puts a nice bow on it. Look what it says. And those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the sky above, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. Now, this book is so amazing. This book covers so much. Some people try to get into it from the perspective of looking at the emperors first, the kings, and I mean, they're certainly significant because they were over cultures and dynasties that essentially ran the known world at that time. But here's the other thing. They speak so much to the fertility of all that. Where are all those dynasties now? They're gone. For as powerful those people were, they're gone. And that should speak to us too, because we can have, and we might not have that kind of power, but we can have influence and power on jobs, in school, and You have to know that this came from God. Nebuchadnezzar actually realized that towards the end of his life. Some people want to focus more on just the Hebrew boys, and they're excellent examples. But here's the key about those Hebrew boys. It's not really even about them. While it certainly isn't about the kings, and it's not fully about them, you know why? Because what it's really about is keeping the main thing. The main thing. It's about the God who orchestrates all of this. The God who superimposes himself over all this. The God who allowed them to stand out like they did. See, here's the thing about them. You're talking about Daniel, you're talking about the three Hebrew boys. Number one, they had influence, they had authority in a pagan government because first and foremost, they trusted their God. They were taken into captivity as teenagers. They didn't just blame God, but they realized, you know what? God has me here for a reason. So therefore, I'm going to serve him here. God has me in this situation as a young person for a reason. So therefore, I'm going to represent him in this situation. God has me on this job for a reason. So therefore, I'm going to show these people who he is. Yeah, I know they get on your nerves and they're cussing and all that, but God has you there for a reason. That's what those guys understood. And they were exalted and lifted up to all these high-ranking positions, not because they went after it and they sought it, but because they humbled themselves and God put them there. That's how we need to be. You humble yourself to him and watch the things he'll do in your life. We talked about their names before. Here's what's so amazing about this book. Daniel, God is my judge. You know what? God is a judge, but he is so gracious. See, that's what you don't get from people. You don't get a judge that's gracious. Who is like God? No one is like him. You know why? Because he is our helper. He's the one that leads us and guides us through it. You see just what God has done just with those names that those boys were given at birth. We're going to take a short clip and watch something related to those boys and wrap everything up right now.
Daniel being put over us, if we allow it to stand, means our demise. Once he is in charge, he'll be looking into everything we do.
Perhaps we should eliminate him.
How?
A hunting accident.
He doesn't hunt.
A sudden illness or a drowning.
Who would believe it?
Maybe we can ensnare him.
How? There is no corruption in him, nor any negligence. He is as diligent as he is skillful.
There must be some way.
He claims he's so effective because three times a day his heart inclines to the city of God. There's a spirit of excellence in him. In every test he has proven faithful.
No one is that honest.
On the contrary, I had a man try to bribe him once, and a very generous bribe at that. He would have no part of it.
Such a man is dangerous. How long before he learns that we've been generous with ourselves and covered the thefts with false accounts?
We'll never be able to find any basis for charges against him unless it has something to do with that God of his. That invisible God of his. No altars, no shrines, no idols, laying claim to every good thing, yet somehow not responsible for the bad.
I've seen him praying before his window, on his knees, facing Jerusalem, morning, noon, and night, always the same.
Then perhaps we need to make him stop.
He won't do it.
Then perhaps we need to make sure he continues. You say there is nothing anyone can do to stop his prayers?
No, nothing.
What if the penalty for this devotion of his was death? If we could forbid his prayers for an entire month under penalty of immediate execution?
Don't be ridiculous. He'll just stop praying.
No, he won't. I know him. He can't keep himself from praying to that God of his for one day, let alone a month.
Well, I still don't see how it'll ever work. The king knows that Daniel and his people pray continuously, and only to one God.
Which is why we need to disguise our purpose.
Amen. You know why I showed that clip? Because that's from the movie, the Book of Daniel, that I showed a clip from last week, which you see the picture right there. I showed it because while it doesn't show those Hebrew boys or Daniel, you know what it shows? It shows how the world sees them. And why does the world see him that way? Because of the faith that Daniel has in his God. You think about the things they're saying, how they see his character, they see his integrity, they see his commitment, his consistency. Why? Because of this God. And they know the only way they can trick him up is to do something related to his God. Can you imagine if the world has that kind of testimony about us? That's why Daniel was able to do these kind of great things. That's why he received the mad revelation that he received. And that's why we need to begin to have lifestyles like that. Like I said, it's about keeping the main thing the main thing, because Daniel knows for a fact that he couldn't do any of that without his God. Daniel prayed in that lion's den. Those three Hebrew boys prayed when they were being placed in that fire. Daniel prayed for all those visions. Daniel didn't say, you know what? Yeah, I can interpret that thing, Nebuchadnezzar, bring it over here. Let me tell you what it means. No, he said, no, I don't interpret things, but there's a God that I serve who does. And this is what your dream was, and this is what it means. We are moving on. We have now finished the books of the major prophets. So we are moving on next time to Hosea. Read through it, see what the Lord is requiring of Hosea, and we'll see you the next time. As you go through this week, remember, read those Psalms, read those Proverbs, read through those 12 chapters of Hosea. Read it, study it, memorize it, meditate on it. You got any questions, put them at the bottom of the page. We'll try to answer them if we need to. After a short time of music, we're going to come right back with Brother Les, as he prepares us for our breaking of bread, our communion, and our elements. Take care. Stay safe. Keep the mask on, please, guys. God bless.
Come on, come on. morning, Montco family and friends. Today I would like to share a message with you from the Old Testament. The scripture verse is in Exodus chapter 3, verses 13 to 14. And it reads, "And Moses said unto God, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The God of your fathers have sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, What is his name? What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am have sent me unto you." Today's message is entitled, The Great I Am. God is sending Moses to the nation of Israel and to Pharaoh. Moses asks an important question, What is your name? God answers with five words. I find it puzzling at first, but as I think about it, it is a perfect answer. Moses was being sent to the nation of Israel and to Pharaoh. Moses would have to tell his brethren that God would deliver them, and he would have to convince Pharaoh, who did not believe in God but believed in multiple gods. The first part of his name, I Am, states that he exists. The second part, that I Am, states that he is who he is, which means he can do what he wants to do. He is all powerful. I would like to share some questions with you, questions that may be the same or similar questions that are being asked in the world today. God, do you exist? God, who are you? God, what is your name? Why should I follow you? Why should I believe in you? How can I approach you? What can you do for me? In the New Testament, we obtain direct answers to these questions. God, do you exist? In John chapter 6, 35, it says, Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. The next question, God, who are you? It says in John chapter 8, verse 12, when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. God, what is your name? His name is Jesus. In John 10, verse 9, it says, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. Also, in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, it says, For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Next question. God, why should I follow you? Because he loves us. In John chapter 10, verse 11, it reads, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. God, why should I believe in you? Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. That's John 11, 25 and 26. God, how can I approach you? John 14 and 6 says, Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. God, what can you do for me? I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. That's John chapter 15, verse 5. The Bible tells us who Jesus is. It says in John chapter 8, verses 57 and 58, it reads, Then said the Jews unto him, Thou art not yet 50 years old. Hast thou seen Abraham? Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. And also in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3, it says that Jesus, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. As we approach the Lord's table, let us remember the Lord's sacrifice for our sins. Let us also remember who he is, and that we too are being sent into the world to a people with many questions. Bless his holy name. Amen. And God bless you.
And good morning, Montco, and I welcome you to another opportunity for us to partake of the elements around the Lord's table and use this as an opportunity to worship the Lord as we remember all that he has done for us. You know, I was thinking about in John 16, when the Lord speaking to his disciples, he likened the fact that he was going to suffer and leave them for a while. He said it's like a woman who goes into labor. And after the child is born, she doesn't remember the pain anymore because a child has been born. And for us now, we remember the pain of the cross and we remember all the suffering. But it also is an opportunity for us to give thanks to the Lord and to worship as we remember the wonderful gift that has been purchased for us. So let's pray together. First of all, if you have some bread, we can partake of the bread together and thank God for his goodness to us by suffering in the body. So Heavenly Father, again, we just thank you for this, another opportunity to come around your people and with your people in communion with you and them. As we eat together, Lord, we remember Jesus. We thank you for enduring all the pain of the cross and crucifixion. We thank you for all that it has done for us. Lord, we just want to say that we love you because you first loved us and you demonstrated that love there on Calvary's cross. And so we ask that you would bless us as we remember and spend this time with you today. In Jesus' name, amen. And if you have some juice, we can lift up our glasses and drink together in communion as we remember the blood that was shed there at Calvary, that blood that has purchased and paid for the redemption that we enjoy. Let's pray together. And Lord, again, we thank you for the precious blood of Jesus. We thank you that it was a satisfactory sacrifice that has accomplished its purpose of redeeming us into right relationship with yourself, of satisfying all of your just demands against our sin. Lord, we are grateful today that we have the privilege of being called the sons and daughters of God, being brought into the family of God and given an eternal hope. And so we appreciate you, we thank you, we worship you, we lift up the name of Jesus, and we do so in remembrance of the blood that was shed there that paid for it all. In Jesus' name, amen. So thank you for spending these moments in communion with the Lord and remembering him around his table. Now let's continue on in our worship around the Word of God.
Hear the worshipers! Where's all of my praises? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go.
It's who I got. Every word of worship. With one accord.
Praise.
It's to our God.
Y'all know how we do it. Take it up. Every praise. It's to our God.
Every word of worship.
With one accord.
Come on, say every praise.
Every praise.
It's to our God.
I want everybody all over the world to sing hallelujah.
To our God.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody, and good morning. Just before we get into the word, we have a special guest with Music Ministry. This is We the Kingdom and Tasha Cobb Leonard.
Like sweet, sweet honey on my
Let's pray. Our God and Father, we thank you, Lord, again for this day that you've given unto us, this opportunity of fellowship. Lord, for many, it's a virtual fellowship, but it is fellowship nonetheless. And so we thank you, Lord, that we are able to gather under these difficult circumstances we find ourselves in. But we thank you that you promised to be in the midst. We ask now, Lord, that as we look into your word, that it would give us both encouragement and exhortation. And we'll thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. One of the things I've found myself doing in the past several months is taking inventory. I don't know how many of you might have ever worked in a place where you had to take inventory, but what you often find is, well, you know, we have too much of this, or we don't have enough of that, you know, or maybe this is expired or outdated. Maybe there's a better version of this. And I've found the same things in my life. You know, there's maybe a little bit too much of this, not enough of that, you know. But as we take inventory in the light of what we're going through today, I believe there are some things in an incident, three incidents in the life of Peter that I want to look at. So let's first turn to Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5, I'll give you a minute to get there. When you're there, say amen. If you're not there, say, wait a minute. Amen. Luke chapter 5, give a listen.
So it was, as the multitude pressed about him to hear the word of God, that he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two boats standing by the lake. But the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. When he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon,
"Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch."
"Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net."
And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats, so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees.
"Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord."
For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish which they had taken. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon,
"Do not be afraid. From now on you will catch men."
So when they had brought their boats to land, they forsook all and followed him.
Luke chapter 5 begins by saying that there was a multitude who pressed about Jesus to hear the word of God. That's interesting enough to me. Most of the time, or many times, folks were following Jesus because of the miracles or because of the food. On this particular occasion, they were following him because they wanted to hear the word of God. I thought that was very interesting. But let's go down to verse 8, where Peter says, "Lord, depart from me, for I am a sinful man." Very interesting. You know, there are those times when we feel very unworthy to be even in God's presence. Now, anybody that knows me knows that I believe that if we focus more on our unworthiness than we do on God's love, that our focus is misplaced. I believe that. But there are those times when we sometimes, I know for me, I'll speak for myself, I wonder sometimes how God even puts up with me. And certainly when you do inventory, and you look back over your life, as I've looked back over my life and some of the things that I've done and some of the things that I've said, I sometimes feel like, Lord, depart from me, because I am a wicked, wicked man. But what's interesting is Jesus' reply to Peter there in verse 10. Jesus says to him, don't worry about it, because from now on, you're going to catch men. At the point where Peter feels just so unworthy to even be in his presence, God gives him a new perspective and a new purpose. And I think he's done the same thing for all of us, so that now it's not so much about fishing for stuff, but it's about fishing for men. Peter is just at a place where he does not feel worthy to be in the presence of God. Now, that is a backdrop. I want us now to look at John chapter 18. Turn to John chapter 18. Give a listen.
And Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. Now that disciple was known to the high priest and went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter stood at the door outside. Then the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to her who kept the door and brought Peter in. Then the servant girl who kept the door said to Peter,
"You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?"
"I am not."
Now the servants and officers who had made a fire of coals stood there, for it was cold, and they warmed themselves. And Peter stood with them and warmed himself.
Says there at the end of verse 18 that Peter stood with them and warmed himself by the fire. I call this the fire of reckoning. This fire was built by some folks who had no regard for Jesus Christ, and they could care less that he had just been hung and died on the cross. And here Peter is warming himself by the fire with these folks. Peter was getting comfortable around these folks, and his comfort around them allowed him not only to compromise his relationship with Christ, but finally actually deny his relationship with the Lord altogether. The more comfortable we are with the world, the more likely we are to compromise our relationship with the Lord. Now, you may say, well, listen, I didn't go as far as Peter and deny that I knew him. And the reality is that we might not say that we don't know him, but oftentimes we act like we don't know him. And I believe that's just as bad. I mean, I could run down the list. Ephesians chapter 4, 32 says, if I harbor unforgiveness in my heart, I believe that you deny him. When I'm only looking out for my own interest and not being concerned about the interest of others, according to Philippians 2, 4, I believe that I deny him. So I could run down the list, but in a nutshell, anytime that our actions are not in harmony and congruent with the Word of God and the teachings of Christ, we deny him. That's what can happen when we warm ourselves by what I call this fire of reckoning. This was a reckoning for Peter. This was Peter's opportunity to stand up and to step up and to come through. The reality is, as I've taken inventory over my own life over the past months, I have come to grips with the times that I have worn myself by the fire of reckoning, and I've come up short at those times. Ah, but thank God, there's another fire, and I call this one the fire of reconciliation. Turn to John chapter 21. John chapter 21. Give a listen.
After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias, and in this way he showed himself. Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them,
"I am going fishing."
We are going with you also.
They went out and immediately got into the boat, and that night they caught nothing. But when the morning had now come, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus.
Children, have you any food?
No.
Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some.
So they cast, and now they were not able to draw it in because of the multitude of fish. Therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garments, for he had removed it, and plunged into the sea. But the other disciples came in the little boat, for they were not far from land, but about 200 cubits, dragging the net with fish. Then, as soon as they had come to land, they saw a fire of coals there, and fish laid on it, and bread.
I really like this. You remember the time when Peter said, "Listen, Lord, depart from me, because I'm just a wicked and sinful man." But this time is very, very different. This time, Peter can't wait to get to Jesus. You know, there are going to be those times when we feel so unworthy to be in his presence, but there are also going to be those times when we are just completely drawn to him. It's interesting that in verse 7, it says, they said to Peter, "It's the Lord." See, this wasn't about the miracle. This was about the master. This wasn't about the fish. It was about the fellowship. It was the relationship. Peter knew how much Christ loved him, and he loved Christ, and he loves us, and we love him because he first loved us. And that's what it was all about at this time. There was a time when Peter messed up. The last time he was around a fire of coals, he messed up big time. But I believe Jesus brings him back, watch this, to a very similar, almost identical situation. I love it. When we are somewhere where we mess it up big time, but God brings us back to a similar situation so that we can get it right the second time. I love that about God. He brings us back to where we messed up and gives us a chance to make it right. I believe that Jesus recreated this scene in Peter's life, not to remind him about his failure, but to remind him about his future. And I believe that because just a few verses down, look in John chapter 21, verses 15 to 17. Take a listen.
So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter,
"Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these?"
"Yes, Lord. You know that I love you."
"Feed my lambs."
He said to him again, a second time,
"Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?"
"Yes, Lord. You know that I love you."
"Tend my sheep."
He said to him the third time,
"Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?"
Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?"
"Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you."
"Feed my sheep."
Most of us know this story. We know that when Jesus said the word love and Peter said the word love, they were two different words. They were talking about two different things. It sounded something like this. Jesus would say to Peter, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you agape me more than these?" And Peter would reply, "Yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you." Second time, Jesus says, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you agape me?" And Peter says, "Yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you." And finally, on the third time, Jesus asks, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you phileo me?" And so we sometimes focus so much on what Jesus was asking Peter that we forget to look at what Jesus was offering Peter. Each time Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" he said to him, "Feed my sheep." How many times did Peter deny Christ? Three times. How many times did Christ give Peter an opportunity to remember that I can still use you? Three times. And I believe that's what he was saying to Peter. Yeah, Peter, you messed up big time at the fire of reckoning, but I'm giving you an opportunity at the fire of reconciliation to remember that I can still use you. I believe he said it to Peter. I believe he's saying it to me, and I believe he's saying it to all of us, especially as we take inventory and just look back over our lives and sometimes are so disappointed of how we've let Christ down. But he's saying to us the same thing he said to Peter. I can still use you. Still got a job for you to do. Still have an anointing on your life. And the interesting thing is that all four of the Gospels record these two incidents. It was important enough to the Spirit of God to make sure that each one of the Gospel writers recorded this so that it could be a constant reminder to us that God still wants to use us, even though sometimes we have failed him and failed him miserably. So that's my encouragement to all of us today. Let's not get stuck at the fire of reckoning, but let's move on to the fire of reconciliation. God bless you.
Well, that's going to do it for us today, Montco Bible Fellowship and our extended family. We thank the Lord for the opportunity to fellowship with you, and we trust that you have felt the presence of the Lord and that those words that come forth are edifying and encouraging to you. And we'd like to pray a prayer of dismissal. But before we do that, I was reminded of a movie that came out in 1971. It's a classic called Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. And for those of you that are familiar with the movie, in this movie, this mystical character, Willy Wonka, hasn't been seen for years, and he lives in this chocolate factory. And the rumor has it he's going to open up the factory. And the key is five people get an opportunity to come inside and really explore this wonderful, amazing place filled with chocolate and candy. But the key is that you have to have, you guessed it, a golden ticket. Unless you have a golden ticket, you can't come to Willy Wonka's Chocolate Factory. Well, the Lord has created that same golden ticket for the kingdom of heaven. The Bible says that that golden ticket is accepting Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. And so if today you can say in your heart that if I were to die today, I am not absolutely sure that I would be in the presence of God. Well, God gives you that assurance today. And so if you would like to know that, so that you would have that assurance and confidence, I'd like for you to pray this prayer with me. Dear Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. I believe that the Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross and was buried and rose again on the third day. He defeated death, and that by accepting him and asking forgiveness, repenting from my sins, that I can receive him as my Lord and Savior and have new life here on earth, but also eternal life with him. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. And the Bible says that when you pray that prayer with sincerity in your heart, because the scripture says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And if you believe that, the Bible says there's a celebration in heaven. And so we thank the Lord for your fellowship with us here today. We pray God's blessings. We pray that the Lord would dismiss us from this place and gathering, but never before his face or his presence. We thank the Lord for you, and we ask that you come back with us, Lord willing, and fellowship with us again. God bless you, and have a great week.